Welcome viewers, a warm welcome to all the Vedic Vision members also. Today we have Babaji ji with us again after a long time. Babaji ji, welcome. I hope
Yeah,
you
thank
have
you
a
very much.
very good session today with us, something new that people
I'll
can
try.
learn. So what are we going to do today?
Today I was thinking this is one of, to discuss one of the most frequently asked astrology queries, you know, and this is regarding transits.
Yeah, very
Because,
interesting.
because many times I see people, they are not very much eager to study, you know, dasha systems, and they're like wanting to know, okay, my Jupiter is transited to fifth house, will I have a child or something like this, huh? Oh, Venus has transited to my seventh house, will I get married or something like this?
Right.
So yeah, so I'll discuss some basic principles which I've seen, they work very beautifully. And always remember, I have said 1,000 times, I will still say that you cannot predict anything by seeing transits. It just doesn't work. So let us use transits, but first we have to check our original birth chart,
Right.
not only our ascendant or moon. No, it's not going to work like that. We have to check where every planet is, what is the dignity, the divisional charts, and you know, the activation years of planets, and so many other things are there. It's a very detailed study. First step, then the first step will tell you what is the level of the horoscope. Like, for example, overall in general, how is the career of this person? Well, okay. Then next step is the dashas, where you get ups and downs or focus changes. But then the first stage is very important. The first step will tell you this person, suppose the person has great dashas for career in the upcoming 30, 40 years. But if the overall horoscope is not supporting, then the person won't rise that high. Also, if the overall chart is very strong and the dashas are not very supportive, then the person will eventually rise when a good dasha comes. You know, may not be now, but eventually the person will rise. So therefore, we should first check the chart and the planets. This is very basic. And then you check the dasha. So many times people think when dashas change, you know, the person changes, they say. Actually, the person doesn't change, the focus changes. Like in Hindi we say na, ye aadmi badal gaya, insaan badal gaya. Actually, wo insaan nahi badalta. The person doesn't change. It is when dasha changes, what happens? A particular area of his or her life, or you could say the brain actually,
the
get
thinking
active
changed. Yeah.
in such a way that the person can does not see. Yes. The person does not see anything beyond that. No? The person feels that, okay, suppose the 10th house is active, it could happen. Okay, the person may be married or he may have children, but his or her focus will be exclusively on matters of career for that particular period of time. Of course, then antardashas will come within the same mahadasha and then things will change. And then we come to our today's topic, which is, you know, transits. And then you use transits to, transits don't tell you what happens actually, that the dashas will tell you. So people ask that what will happen. So then you have to see the dashas. But if somebody asks you, okay, I know this dasha is promising me marriage. For example, somebody's seventh house is activated. So then that person might get married. But then the person may ask you, okay, I will get married, but this antardasha is very long. Within that, when? Then you can go to pratyantar dashas, which can narrow it down. But sometimes even then, you know, you get pratyantar dashas, which are, you know, 2 months, 3 months, sometimes 4 or 5 months long.
Okay.
If it is Venus Mahadasha, Saturn Antardasha, then, you know, within that Saturn, Venus are like 5, 6 months so long. Then, yeah, you want to say something?
Please come.
Yeah. So in that case, or even if it is a pratyantar of 1 month, okay, even then, how do you know when will things happen, and when, or you can also use these techniques to arrange your life in a way. Suppose you know that this dasha is going to give me this, you have some knowledge of astrology, and ideally not some good knowledge. And you know that this pratyantar will give me these opportunities. So, for example, suppose you know that there could be a probable promotion in this, pratyantar dasha, because the antardasha and mahadasha are very supportive. Then you can use these same principles to see when can I apply for that job, or when can I have my interview. Or many times these days, people give a lot of online examinations where they can sit and schedule themselves. Okay, this is the day I will write the test. When should I write it? Okay. So therefore, you can use this for predictions and for improving your own life also. Okay. So now when we will discuss, we assume that you already know what the dasa has promised, and we are taking a guarantee that that event is happening. No doubt. Nobody is going to stop it. So suppose you are about to get a promotion and you are going to get the promotion. Now, how do you narrow it down, to the day or to the week at the least? So what I've seen is here, you have to use multiple techniques. So for example, you have to know the event. Whenever we are talking of astrology, we always have to be event specific, not, planet specific, because planets keep changing. For somebody, Venus is fifth lord. For somebody, Venus is, sixth lord. So you can't say that Venus dasha has come or Venus has transited, you will get married or something always. It doesn't work like that. But you know that if somebody is talking of marriage, for that person or for anybody else, there will always be three houses of marriage. That will never change, which is the second house, the seventh house, and the 11th house. So once you know this, that what works for everybody, then you see what works for me. So for you, it means which planets are, the lords of these houses. So the second lord, seventh lord, and 11th lord, when are they transiting in each other's houses? Because that amplifies the energy, second lord is transiting in the seventh. So it's like your family's focus has shifted to your marriage for that time. That increases the probability that, okay, suppose I might get married within this time. Then okay, when is this planet exactly transiting? You can check in the panchang. When is my second lord transiting the seventh? So in that case, that is an auspicious time to select a muhurat or something. Because in case that doesn't happen and the planet is still in the sixth house, then there could be disputes when the wedding is taking place. Okay, then that's not a great time, of course. So when you see that the lords of these houses are transiting in each other's houses, 11th lord in second, second lord in seventh or 11th, or seventh lord in second or 11th, these exchanges are going on, then it's a very powerful time. And let's talk for career progress. We have the second house, the sixth house, the 10th house, and the 11th house. So if the 10th lord or the 11th lord, they are transiting in each other's houses, or, there is a parivartana in transit, okay, from your original birth chart, then these are very beautiful times to actually get that event done. Or maybe if you're talking from a prediction perspective, then that you might predict that, okay, during these days, this event will happen. And also you have to check primarily the transit of the moon. The transit of the moon is very important, because moon is the mind, moon is the society, that which impacts you. You cannot get a promotion unless you are aware of it, It could happen that somebody has announced somewhere and you come to know it. It's like, okay, I didn't know that somebody told me I got a promotion. That could also happen. But even then, ultimately, at the end of the day, your name may be there in the board or wherever, but you have to feel that. Unless you feel it at the level of the mind, you cannot experience that. Even if that is there, it will not do anything good, any good to you. Nor it might not even do any bad to you, because you have not felt it. Your manas, which is the mind, has no conception. It's not aware. So it's like saying that, oh, I got a promotion, but I'm not aware of it. It's very funny, but it's like saying like that. It's like, as they say, a rich person, he had a child, and that child is not aware that my father is so rich, and the person goes on begging alms from others, and then one day one of his father's friend sees him, and he's like, oh, he's my friend's son, his father is a millionaire, so I'll take him to my friend, my millionaire friend. So it's like that. So the transit of the moon is very important. So be very event specific. If you're talking of getting married, then you have to see when is moon transiting the second, seventh, and the 11th. And once you see this, then you will sometimes see that these are happening, but it's still not working for you. And then you have to use some other techniques, which I have seen they work brilliantly. Like, for example, in your birth chart, if there is any planet who is sitting in these particular houses, like let's talk of career, if you have a planet in 10th house, or like, for example, Saturn is there in your 10th house. Now, if you see that this same Saturn in current day's transit is transiting these other houses or the 10th house itself, the second, sixth, 10th, and 11th, then you know that this energy, which is already there in my 10th house, is now getting amplified by this transit. And of course, we have already assumed that the thing is happening because the dashas have promised. Okay. So you cannot apply this backwards. You cannot say, oh, I have Saturn in 10th. Now Saturn has transited my 10th house. I am having this Saturn return. So I must get a promotion. No, that will come from the dashas. Your Saturn may be in the 10th. Great. And your Saturn may be transiting in the 10th house now. For example, if you are Aries Lagna, then now Saturn is in your 10th house. And if somebody is born around that time, 91, 92, then you will have Saturn in Capricorn. But does it mean that every Aries ascendant who is born in 91, 92 will keep getting promotions? No, it doesn't work like that. What if somebody is running a different dasha? Somebody may be running Mercury dasha, third lord, sixth lord, not that great. So then you may have struggles in career on the other side. So then that's very important. If you have a planet which is already placed in these houses, or you know that that planet who has transited, like in this case, if Saturn has transited to your 10th house, if in your original birth chart, these planets are at least conjunct with the lords of these houses. So suppose if the second lord and the sixth lord are conjunct, and then the second lord is, they may be conjunct anywhere. They may be conjunct in the fifth house also, which has nothing to do with, career or promotions. In fact, would be sometimes negative indeed, because it's 12th from the, sixth and it's 8th from the 10th. Sometimes it can be negative indeed. But even though it is in a neutral house or maybe in a negative house, but it is conjunct the lord of the sixth house. So even then, if this fifth lord transits your 10th house, I have seen sometimes good things happen, great things happen actually. And also I have seen in my experience, if there are two or three planets, or at least two planets in your original birth chart, which are indicating great career and great progress. For example, suppose a planet is placed in a particular nakshatra, and the nakshatra lord is sitting in the 10th house, or it's sitting in the 11th house, great placement. And you have another planet whose nakshatra lord is sitting in the 6th house, for example. So these planets become very powerful by level of the nakshatra, because their nakshatra lords are extremely well placed for career. And these planets in itself may be placed anywhere in your chart, but because the nakshatra lords are connected to the money house, the second, sixth, 10th, and 11th, then you know this planet is very powerful. So when the dasha of this planet comes, extremely powerful it is. Okay, so for example, if your Rahu is placed in, Shravan nakshatra, for example, Rahu may be placed anywhere, any house, no, doesn't matter. But who is the lord of Shravan? It's the moon. The moon is placed in your 11th house. Then Rahu is great for career, name, fame, and finances. And as I said, you have another planet who is also great. Suppose Jupiter is also placed in another moon's nakshatra, which is another moon's nakshatra, like, for example, Rohini nakshatra is there. Or, yeah. So then you know that Jupiter is also very strong because his nakshatra lord is also sitting in a money house. Okay. Now, in your transit, if these two planets, Jupiter and Rahu, they come together, which happens very rarely, but if they come together, then you know it's a great time. And this technique, I have seen this works brilliantly. Sometimes you see dashas are promising something, but the result is not coming, which doesn't mean it will not come, but there is a bit delay. So then you see, okay, when are these planets, which are originally very well placed in their charts, when are they coming together, or even if they are aspecting each other? Because Jupiter and Rahu may not come together for a very long time because they
Correct.
are slow moving planets, you see. But they may aspect each other
From
because
prime.
they aspect. Yes, correct. Five houses away, you know, they may aspect each other, or they may be seven houses away from each other. Okay. So then also the energy is getting magnified, because many times people say, oh, this transit happened. What actually happened? What happens when there is a transit? It's very simple. Some energies get magnified in your life. It is just simple. It's nothing more than that. The dashas give activation, and when something activates, then the transits come and they will magnify it, you know, and then you will start feeling, oh yeah, finally this thing is happening in my life at the end of the day. So yeah, so if you have two planets or three planets which are good for, again, specific to events, not just like this, oh, my Mercury is good, you know, Saturn is nice, you know, they are conjunct in transit, nothing is happening in my life, you know, not like this. You know, you have to be very event specific. And sometimes I have seen the opposite happens. You know, sometimes if you, in your birth chart, if you have a planet who is sitting in the eighth or in the 12th and in transit now, if they combine, then I have seen big problems happening. And especially if they are slow moving planets, then it gets very tough, because then for 1 year or 2 years or 18 months sometimes, you know, suppose you have Saturn in 12th and Jupiter in 8th, and now they are hovering around each other in this transit. And imagine that your lagna is also bad, that this is also falling in a dustana, or you know, in a house which is not conducive for that event. Like for example, if you are married and this placement is happening in your sixth house, for example, and in your birth chart you have this Jupiter and Saturn in you know, eighth and 12th. Oh, and if you're a Leo Lagna, because for Leo Lagna these two are in the sixth house now, okay, and originally also they have this energy of the 12th and the eighth. You know, eighth is defamation and 12th is, you know, loss, and now they are conjunct, and that too in the sixth house of disputes. Okay, and to add to it, if the dasha is negative for your married life, then this can really wreak havoc in your life. But suppose this is positive, you know, your Saturn is in second house in your birth chart, your Jupiter is, you know, in the seventh house, or suppose it's for career, then for a Leo Lagna person this can be great, because sixth house is a house of money. Okay, so therefore this is how you check, and this works for mutual aspects also. So if they're mutually aspecting, as I said, then also it works. And you will never find a chart where all these things are happening together. You will always
Just
see
one
some.
question I have.
Yeah, please.
Take the Saturn example, Saturn in the 10th house. And now,
Yes.
if Saturn comes in 2, 2nd house, 6th house, 10th house, or 11th house, so it will
Correct.
trigger that thing. So here you're
Correct.
not seeing Saturn aspects, the normal aspects of 3, 7, 10. You're not taking that. It has just to come in those houses.
Yeah, I have seen if they come, then they give results specifically. And if suppose Saturn has transited your fourth house and then he's aspecting the 10th house, then I have generally seen it's like a desire is there and I want a promotion, but for that the dasha has to be very strong, and some other planets has to transit, you know, some good houses, like for career the 10th house or the 11th specifically. Then I have seen it happens. But again, for if you ask for Saturn exclusively, then I have seen Saturn as he's the character for, you know, dissatisfaction sometimes. So it will happen that you will get a promotion, but it could mean that, you know, you are not very happy there, or you may not get perks. Like natural benefits, I have seen they will always give you a lot of perks. Like for example, if somebody has a Saturn in 10th house and Saturn dasha is active, he or she may get a promotion. But Jupiter may also be there in some other person's 10th house, and that person's Jupiter dasha may get activated, and then that person may also get a promotion. But what is the difference between Jupiter and Saturn? The difference is the kind of people that you meet, the differences of the ambience, the place where you are. You know, if Jupiter is giving you a promotion, he won't just give you a promotion. He will also give you, you know, this flower bouquet. He'll give you a mobile. He'll give you a nice laptop. You'll get a big cabin. You know, people will come and salute you. People will share your posts. But if
Right.
it is Saturn, okay, not bad. Life's good. Yeah. So yeah. So that's how you see. So aspects also work. I've seen aspects sometimes give the desire that, you know, I want this, but necessarily I have not seen they working. But yeah, if those planets which are good for that event, if they are mutually aspecting each other in transit, then even if I have seen they are not related to these houses of the event, even then this happens. For example, if somebody has like in your case, for example, you said Saturn is in 10th house of somebody's birth chart. And suppose, you know, Saturn comes to third house for somebody, and maybe there is another planet, Mercury, who is in the 11th, and Saturn, Mercury goes to 9th. They are mutually aspecting each other. Then this really becomes like a power packed event, because you may be thinking, oh, I thought, you know, Mercury is the Karaka for 10th house. He will enter 10th house and he will give me good results. But oh, he was in the 9th and he gave me all this, because these energies are now connecting. And I've always seen it. It doesn't just happen out of the blue. It doesn't happen like this. It will always be related to the planets, the nature of the planet. So if it is Mercury, you have to give some exam and you have to crack an exam or an interview or something like this, you know, then that will be like the hallmark. If it is Jupiter, it will not be much written or much of the knowledge. It will be of, do you have a vision for, suppose somebody is giving you a new position or team lead or somewhere, they will see, you may not know all the details or you may not even know the technology, but do you have a proper vision that, okay, I want to do this with these subordinates that I have. So if Jupiter dasha is running, then that is more important than your mercurial skills and all this, because many times people say, oh, what do I need to do to get a promotion? Sometimes I see Jupiter dasha is running and the person is just brushing up with his or her skills, you know, Mercurian knowledge, you know, going to sites and looking interview questions and all this. But sometimes you may answer everything, but if they feel that you do not have that necessary knowledge which is required to carry, because having information is different, but taking, you know, 10 people together and managing, that is a totally different thing. You know, it has nothing to do with information actually. So if Jupiter is there, and Jupiter is related to vision, basically, I have seen, you know, what do you want to do? And if Sun is your Dasha Lord or Sun is transiting the 10th, then you have to really be commanding. You have to say, yes, I will make people do this. I can make strong decisions. Yes, when required, you know, they may ask you in the interview, have you faced difficulties? You know, what did you do that time? You know, yes, I have made this decision and I had stick to it, because Sun always rises. So when Sun dasha is there, you have to stick to what you are saying. You can't just keep saying, oh, I think this doesn't work, you know, we'll change something. You may change if required, not to be fanatic and stubborn. That's a symptom of a bad Sun. But another symptom of a bad Sun is you're too much fluctuating. And one symptom of bad Mercury can be you are very stubborn. So you got to have that balance. When I have made a decision, I will do everything that is required to get the results. But if then also it's not working, then it's foolishness to just stay there just because, you know, it was my decision. So we have to have that flexibility, you know. And yeah, if it is Venus, then my God, I've seen always presentation. Yeah, presentation. How it's like, many times the people say, na, ultimately, it depends on how the person feels when somebody is interviewing you, you know. So if Venus dasha is running, then you really have to take care that you are giving a good first impression. You know, your clothes are nice if you're going for an interview, and you know, you are sitting nicely, talking properly, you know. Ultimately, the person should feel that you are a good person. Now, you may have Mercury or you may not have the skill. You may have Jupiter, you may not have. But ultimately, Venus is going to give you something. You have to tune into that energy. So you can use this for transits also. If suppose Mercury transits your 10th, you may need to use your skill. If Venus transits, you may need to focus on the presentation, how you are presenting something, okay? Or if Mercury transits, you may just speak. You may take a mic and you are just going on speaking. But if Venus is transiting, that may not work. People may be bored. So then what do? You give a presentation, slideshow, anything that you see that is Venus. So that's how you can use transits. It's very simple. You know the basics. And if there are prominent planets in your original birth chart, which are already indicating positive things related to that particular event, just check when are they transiting these houses, or when are they aspecting each other, or they are getting conjunct with each other. Or sometimes I have also seen they transit over each other. So for example, if Saturn is in your 10th house in your birth chart, and Mercury is in your second house, or Mercury is your second lord, and in transit, Saturn transits over your Mercury or your 10th lord, or Jupiter transits or Rahu transits, then also I have seen results coming. Okay. But you have to go stepwise. First is horoscope, no compromises with that. That will tell you the level. Then dashas, very, very, very important. Mahadashas first, then antardashas, then pratyantara. Dashas may not tell you when it will happen, but dashas will tell you what will happen.
Correct.
And then lastly, you use transits. Okay, I know dasha has promised this will happen, but now when will it happen? Which day or which week will it happen? So once you know that, then you use transits and you will get good accuracy, 80 to 90%. But many times we go wrong because we think that, oh, this transit is happening here, this should have happened. But no, it didn't happen because the dasha did not promise that. Okay, so whatever dasha promises will happen has to happen at any cost.
Correct, very correct. And people nowadays see only transits, okay, this is there, why it is not happening. But dasha should promise, and main thing is there should be a proper dasha at proper time. That
yes,
is also
yes,
very important.
Yeah, like somebody told me recently that this Jupiter has transited, or it will transit to Aquarius now and again, end of this year. So he told me, oh, what if, an unmarried person is there, in his seventh house, this transit is happening at the age of 65. Then what will happen? Astrology will fail. Astrology doesn't work. I said, it's not like that. You have to see if the dasha is promised. Then you also have to use this kalpatra, time, place, circumstances. Even if a person of 75, he is running the dasha of the seventh house, it's highly unlikely that the person will get married. Of course, nowadays anything can happen. You might get married these days. That's different. But there's something known as common sense, which is very uncommon in people of Kali Yuga today. They will ask these questions. They'll say, oh, 65 mein guru ka gochar ho gaya, shadi kaise nahi hua. So you have to use time, place, circumstances. You have to see where the person is located, where the person is born. For example, Jupiter may transit your second house and you may be of the age of, 25. But what if you are born in a place and you stay somewhere, where marriages are happening only after 32, 35? Then that transit will have no effect for you. Even if dashas may promise, then seventh house may mean something else.
Correct.
Because the Deshkal Patra is, it's not harmonizing. Because ultimately, any horoscope, any astrology, it's like a reflection of the society. So you cannot put society outside of the horoscope. The society is also, you have to consider the society at any cost when you are making predictions, using astrology. You cannot dismiss it right away. Then common sense is always there. Okay, this person is between 25 to 35, and then the dasha promises, and or new job around this time, people start new job, or people go for master's education, or 28 to 35 PhD sometimes. Then you have to use your brain, because sometimes fourth house is active. What the hell, what in the universe, what the hell does it mean, fourth house? If it is for a person who is like married and has two kids and is settled, then it might mean property. Mars and Saturn are involved. Then you check the Chaturthamsha and confirm, is it really linked to the Chaturthamsha's fourth house? Or it could be the person is saying, yes, I'm done with two kids and family, now I want to go and do MBA, or masters, whatever, something like this. So you have to use the Deshkal and Patra. There's no substitute for that. Right? That's it from my side.
That's very true. Common sense above everything.
Yeah. You can also add, definitely. I'm sure you have many wonderful Nadi techniques to add.
Yeah, so in Nadi, though, transit is most important, of course, but the main chart is prime, as you said. Main chart is prime. If there are yogas which promise certain event, first the chart should show me that.
Oh, yes.
Then we will go into transits and progressions.
And one small query I had for you, this I thought I'll ask you regarding this degrees they say na in Nadi, if transit, some planet is transiting over 1 degree of another planet, then like How do you use it? I mean, in short, if you can just say.
That becomes very difficult in such just 2 or 5 minutes, because
Okay.
degrees of planets, you really have to look too much deep into it. Like,
Okay.
let's give you a small example. Say I have a Saturn sitting in the first house,
Correct.
Ketu sitting in trine to it, either in 5 or 9, or maybe in
In
one also,
your birth chart.
in the birth chart. Everything is in the birth
Okay.
chart. Or
Okay,
maybe
correct.
together also.
Okay.
Okay. Now Saturn is say 10 degrees and Ketu is say 15 degrees. Okay. So Saturn
Okay.
is going towards Ketu and Ketu is going towards Saturn.
Okay, two is retrograde, correct.
Correct. So in this
Correct.
case, the problems will be there in profession and karmas of the person.
Oh, अच्छा,
And the
okay.
settlement will happen only after 32 years in this case.
Oh, अच्छा.
Okay. And but now say if this is the same condition with Saturn at 15 degrees and Ketu at 10 degrees.
Okay.
Was it? So now Ketu is
Okay.
going and it is not meeting
Yes.
Saturn. Saturn has already crossed Ketu. So
Okay.
conjunction is there, Saturn Ketu. Means problems
Yes.
there in karma, problems there in profession, but now
Correct.
the intensity has reduced too much.
Okay, or maybe eventually the person will come out of it.
In both cases,
Okay.
they will come out. That is not there.
Okay.
But
Okay.
now this person can have settlement anytime, even before 30 or something, if the other
Okay.
yogas are right in the chart or whatever.
So this 32 rule year rule applies for that only, not for any Saturn Ketu conjunction.
No, it does not. No.
Okay.
That 32-year rule does not apply ekdam pakka for that. It can be 40 years,
Okay.
it can be
Okay.
45 years, anything, it can be anything. There is a full
Okay. Got it.
progression rule behind it.
Okay.
So that is very different and difficult. To learn
Okay.
progression is the best part of marriage. Either
Okay,
we don't follow
excellent.
the dasha system, we don't follow anything, only progression. That's it.
Okay, excellent. Great. Thank you so much. That will be all from my side.
Thank you very much. It was a very beautiful session. I hope people love it. And folks, let me tell you all, Babaji ji runs a YouTube channel by the name of Exotic Astrology, very famous, many followers. So I think all my followers also follow him very widely. Still, I will give links in the description box. He's also into consultations and everything. Please go and have a look at his channel. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much.